We just discussed the physical dimension of the zero-emission mobility system of the future. As you now understand, the future mobility system will not only require electric vehicles, it is also going to require substantial change in the electric power system. Now, lean back and think for a moment. Imagine that you know all physical components in the future power and mobility system. Would you be able to predict how the system behaves? The engineering professionals among you may be disappointed to admit that you cannot. Even if you knew the millions of components, even billions of components in the system and their technical specifications, you cannot know how and when exactly each consumer uses the electricity consumption devices in his home, in the office, and on the road. Evidently, there is a lot more to system behavior than just physical components and technical specifications. It is also about user behavior, which brings us to the social dimension of the system. The system components or the system elements in the social dimension of the system are known as actors. Actors may be individual consumers, like you and me. They may be established organizational entities, like private companies and governmental bodies, or they may be ad hoc organizations formed to serve specific interests. Actors making investment and disinvestment decisions will determine if and how the power and mobility system evolves. Actors producing and using electricity will determine if and how the future power system can be balanced. In turn, governmental agencies, regulatory bodies, and system operators may design incentives to influence investment and consumer behavior. However, while government may be designing policies to incentivize you and me to buy electric vehicles, established engine and car manufacturers in the meantime may be pursuing different propositions for consumers, such as more efficient and cleaner combustion engines. In other words, there are many, many interactions between actors in the system. And these interactions are non-linear, as actors in the system are reflective. They learn and they adapt. So even if we know all the individual actors, we cannot predict the whole system's behavior. Such systems are known as complex adaptive systems. The complexity stems from the dynamic interactions between the components, millions of components, with feedback loops among actors across subsystems and timescales, implying that we cannot predict the behavior of the aggregate system from our understanding of the individual actors and the individual physical system components. The behavior of the aggregate system is an emergent property of the system. Its behavior evolves from the actions and interactions between the actors, between the physical components, and between the social and technical subsystems. The interactions may involve information exchange, financial transactions, power flows, material flows, and so on. The actors are autonomous decision-making agents, and they are heterogeneous. They are heterogeneous, for example, in the sense that they do not have the same information, they do not pursue the same goals, they do not have the same means to enforce their agenda. They may be willing to take risks or be risk-aversive. They may be competitive or willing to collaborate, and so forth. The learning and adaptive behavior of the actors implies that the aggregate system is also adaptive. Microevents in the system, or changes in the economic, social, and physical environment of the system, thus induce the system to change and exhibit new and possibly unforeseen system behavior. And at the same time, complex adaptive systems exhibit so-called path dependencies, implying that the system behavior is also determined by the system's history. Think, for example, of capital investment decisions made in the past. Complex adaptive systems are all around us. Examples are the climate system, urban systems and ecosystems. And at lower system levels, you can see animal swarms, insect colonies, and our own bodies as complex adaptive systems. But also, both the power system and the mobility system can be characterized as complex adaptive systems. Both are characterized by physical networks that extend across a variety of geographical scales and jurisdictions, and by networks of heterogeneous actors using, operating, and managing these networks, and actors providing technologies and services. Analytically, you can distinguish between the physical and social dimension, but in practice you cannot. These are just the different sides of the same coin. You cannot isolate the social from the physical dimension of the system. We are dealing with a complex, adaptive, socio-technical system. The current mobility system is intricately intertwined with the fossil energy system, as it largely depends on fossil fuels. According to the US Energy Information Administration, in 2016, nearly three quarters of the total petroleum consumption in the US was in the transportation sector. And mind you, the US petroleum consumption equals more than 20% of the world's oil consumption. So vehicle manufacturers and oil companies and their suppliers established a mobility system that revolves around petroleum-derived fuels. While electric vehicles are already entering the market in increasing numbers, old cars still need to be refueled with gasoline and diesel, and most people are still buying gasoline and diesel-fueled cars rather than electric vehicles. In view of the capital invested, and this is just an example of path dependency, the established industrial base, you know, the oil refineries, the refueling infrastructure and vehicle park cannot be replaced overnight. Historic investment decisions as well as social routines have created path dependencies, hindering the mobility system to easily switch to a zero emission electric mobility system. The new system requires new physical components, both in the mobility system and in the energy system, if the zero emission mobility system is to be brought into being. And it requires established actors to reconsider their roles and new actors to take on new roles. While Tesla is a new car manufacturer that is fully dedicated to electric vehicles, established car manufacturers are still improving the fuel efficiency of their combustion engine cars, while at the same time they are also producing hybrid and all-electric cars. Battery electric cars will be competing with fuel cell electric cars and with combustion engine cars designed for example, hydrogen combustion. While recharging infrastructure for electric cars is taking shape, we also see hydrogen refueling infrastructure evolving, and we see biogas and biodiesel refueling infrastructure being installed to service traditional combustion engine cars. In some of these cases, established actors are taking the lead, and in others, new actors are entering the stage. For electric vehicles, recharging infrastructure is a crucial enabler, and with the need for smart charging, a new type of actor is entering the market, the so-called aggregator. The aggregator is the link between the electric power and the mobility system, and the aggregator serves both. By shifting demand to times when electricity is cheap, especially when renewable energy is abundantly available, the aggregator is helping to avoid overload of the electricity distribution network, especially during peak demand, but he is also reducing the recharging costs for the electric vehicle owner. Let us dive a bit deeper now into the social dimension of the system in which electric vehicles are claiming their role. We already discussed that the power and mobility system is a complex adaptive system in which many different actors play a role. On the one side, we are dealing with established industries and infrastructure providers. And on the other side, new actors are entering the stage, such as dedicated electric vehicle manufacturers. And we see new actors adopting new roles, such as aggregators. Consumers are obviously important actors too, and governments play an important role. This course is too short to give you a comprehensive overview of all relevant actors. The important message here for you is to understand that the values and goals of all these different actors may not be aligned. To understand this phenomenon just a bit better, we introduce the notion of competing values. The competing values framework builds along two axes to identify the different types of values actors might have. The first axis is the one that classifies actors on the basis of their flexibility or preference for stability. And the second axis identifies actors based upon how internally or externally oriented they are. And these two axes make four different quadrants. In the top right corner are those actors that are flexible and externally oriented. And this is what we call the create profile. These are actors that do not feel bound by regulations and try to innovate, even radically. In the bottom left corner are organizations that are quite the opposite and whose values can thus compete. The actors in the bottom left quadrant are called control actors. For the organizations situated in this control quadrant, risk is not really an option. They have a strong preference for maintaining the status quo, for certainty, for risk avoidance, and to that end, they employ all control options at their disposal. Another example of competing values is that between those actors in the lower right corner, the so-called compete quadrant, and in the upper left, the collaborate quadrant. While the competitors are short-term focused on private gains, the collaborators are more externally focused and ready to establish collaborative coalitions with other actors which share their values and which are willing to cooperate towards a shared higher goal. Sustainable development largely builds on the latter type of actors. In designing effective policy interventions for complex adaptive systems, governments may decide to set up experiments and pilots because governments themselves also have to learn, you know, about which interventions are more effective than others. In the Netherlands and many other countries, a variety of local experiments has been set up with smart grids and smart charging of electric vehicles. For such experiments, coalitions of actors have to be established, which are most easily recruited, obviously, from the create and collaborator quadrants, and less easily from the control and compete quadrants. So setting up a coalition of the willing is a challenging task in itself, as it will involve actors from the public as well as the private sector, which goals and values are not naturally aligned. Another challenge is that experimental settings rarely fit with the established rules and regulations, so that exemptions may be needed from current legislation. And this brings us to the institutional dimension of the system, which is the subject of the next lecture.